Okay, so today I would like to speak about some concepts which has been developed in the beginning of late 90s, probably, which is a concept of domination between representations of surface group in PSL2R again. So let me give the definition. So this is a way of comparing representations of surface group in groups of isometries. So the definition is the following. So let G rho be two representation of the fundamental group of, again, S is a closed, oriented, connected surface of genus larger than or equal to 2. And we take two representations. One is called G, and rho is, the other is called rho. So let's we say that G J dominates rho if let's put the definition in that way. If there exists a Lipschitz map from upper half plane to itself. Lipschitz map which is J rho equivariant meaning that so this terminology means that for any x in H2 and for any gamma in the fundamental group of our surface, we have phi of J of gamma X equals rho of gamma phi of X. Right? So this is a kind of order between representation, a way of comparing representations, various representations of the same fundamental group of a surface in PSL2R. And in fact, there is an alternative way of, a more strong version of domination, which we will call strictly, I don't know, maybe this is not good. Use here. So we will say that G J strictly dominates rho if there exists a Lipschitz map, so but with a constant of a Lipschitz constant which is strictly less than 1. So Lipschitz map means that the distance between the image of 2 points is decreased by by the map, so this should be true for any couple of points in the upper half plane. And for strict domination, we will ask for a C Lipschitz map with C a constant between 0 and 1. And this means that we have this inequality for any couple of points x and y in upper half plane, right? So what we are going to do today? So yesterday, what we did? Yesterday, we defined the volume of representations, and we saw that it can take only a finite number of values, and we announced the result that the representation of maximal volume in modulus R as a function or anti-function representations. Today we are going to prove, in fact, something more than that. We are going to in fact, yesterday we proved that with respect of volume, Fuchsian representations are maximal. Today we are going to prove that this is also true for the domination, namely that if you take so Fuchsian representation are maximal representation with respect to domination. So in general, so J will always be the representation which dominates. So this will be the notation. And in fact, we are going to prove that Fuchsian ones are the maximal ones. So J will play the role of the Fuchsian representation. Okay. So here, in fact, this action, you can just think of this action as being the action of the fundamental group of the surface on its universal cover once you have hyperbolized your surface with a hyperbolic structure corresponding to the J. Right. So this will be the plan for today. And as a corollary, we will get of the proof that Fuchsian representation are maximal with respect to domination, we will get Goldman theorem that this is they are also maximal with respect to the volume. Sorry?
What's the meaning of maximal domination?
So here you see that this notion of domination gives you an order in the set of representation. Namely, you will say that one representation is bigger than another representation if it dominates it. Right? This is an order. In fact, it's transitive, and so if J dominates J, let's say rho, and rho dominates J, then rho is equal to J. If J dominates rho, and rho dominates let's say rho prime, then J dominates rho prime. But this is an order, total, okay? This is not a total order, but it is an order. So maximal with respect to this order. This is not so clear to prove these kind of things. Up to conjugation, yeah, right.
Well, if I have two Fuchsian representations, okay, up to conjugation, yeah.
Sorry, up to conjugation. So those things are not so trivial to prove. I will try to not speak about this order, but there is an order which comes from domination, and in fact, what we are going to prove today is that the maximal element with respect to that order are Fuchsian representations.
Sorry, you give any two representations, is there any one dominating one?
No, this is not a total order. So sometimes you cannot compare representations.
No.
Ah, is it a tree or a lattice or something? I don't think so. Have you understood the question? So for the
two different Fuchsian representations, there is nobody going to dominate.
They're right. Good. So it's not. Yeah, right. Yeah. So we will see that we cannot dominate. So a Fuchsian representation is maximal. So if you take two different, you cannot dominate. Right, there are many maximal elements. So we can wonder why we are caring about this kind of order on representations, and in fact, I would like to say some words. So in fact, it is related, this concept of domination, to the construction of space-time in three dimensions, which are quite different from the space-times that Todd was speaking about in his two lectures. Namely, these space-time are curved space-time of constant negative curvature. These are called ADS manifolds. So those are manifolds equipped three-dimensional. So these are three-dimensional manifolds equipped with a Lorentz metric, so a family of metrics on the tangent space whose curvature has 1, 2, is a 1, 2 curvature, so Lorentz metric. And we ask that the curvature of those metrics is negative. So the curvature form is minus the metric. So, in fact, I decided not to describe exactly the structure of these manifolds, but what I can say really briefly is that there is a model for this ADS3 geometry. So it's a rigid geometry which can be described locally by a standard model. And the model, I can tell you in a word what it is. This is, you take this group, PSL2R, this is a three-dimensional manifold, and you equip this, so you think of this as being a three manifold, and you put on it what is it called? So we heard the killing form. So thank you. Thank you very much. The killing form you were describing yesterday, maybe yesterday, Tom. So you consider the killing form, which is of signature 1, 2 on this Lie group, and so this is a Lorentzian manifold with a lots of symmetry. Namely, if you multiply by an element of PSL2R on the left, it's going to be to preserve this killing form. And also, if you multiply by an element on the right, it's going also to multiply to preserve this killing form. And this is the model for for this geometry. And in fact, there has been many works, beginning with in the 80s by theorem by Raymond and Kulkarni, and many people proved that in fact such manifolds, if they are compact up to finite coverings, they are all of the form PSL2R divided by following relation X, an element of PSL2R that I call X, maybe add here, G. If you take G, an element of PSL2R, you are going to identify it with rho gamma, let's say J gamma, G rho gamma inverse, where G and rho are two representations from a certain fundamental group of a certain surface of genus larger than 2 in PSL2R, that such that G strictly dominates rho. So there are many non-trivial things to be seen. So maybe one thing that is not so hard to see, and that I let as a, let's say, hard exercise, it's an exercise to see that if you have a domination, a strict domination, so assume that rho is strictly dominated by J, then this action, so the action of the fundamental group of S on PSL2R given by this formula acts properly discontinuously on PSL2R. So this is my exercise that I propose. And in fact, you can also prove that the quotient of PSL2R by this such an action is compact. So this is not so difficult to prove that. So in fact, those three manifolds are quite easy to define, but it is quite very difficult to prove that this gives you up to finite index the list of all closed ADS three manifolds. So maybe to put some names, So Kulkarni and Raymond, I don't know how to pronounce his name in English, Raymond, proved that quotients of the universal cover of this group that are compact are given by such a form where G and rho are some representations. Maybe at this time we didn't know that rho had to be dominated by J. Then there is a theorem by, I hope I will not, by Klingler, saying that in fact any Hds closed three manifold has to be covered by this the universal cover of this model. So essentially this model. and then the fact that the representation rho has to be strictly dominated by G is quite recent theorem by Fanny Kassel. I hope I don't miss names in this classification. So, sorry?
Everybody has to start with K.
Yeah, that's right. That's a good remark. There's 3K, three-dimensional. I don't know. Okay. Now, so I won't speak more. Sorry?
Why is it F? What's AD?
Anti-de-Sitter. Anti-de-Sitter manifold. Okay, I won't speak more about these space times and three-dimensional geometry. I will really focus on this notion of domination for representations of surface group in PSL2R. So let me try to see what I want to say now. Okay. Okay, so maybe I will state more precisely some results about dominations, and then we will go to the proofs. So the first result. So maybe there is a recent result which in a sense closes this story of classification of Hds free manifold. Sorry, I said that I didn't spoke more about that, but we should put a name here. Nicolas Tolozon, who recently proved the following theorem. And next, I am going to give some particular case of this theorem, which is a theorem which can be stated only in terms of representations of surface group, but in fact, it really closed the story of the classification of those closed three-dimensional Hds manifolds. So the theorem is the following. For any representation rho of volume satisfying, so not maximal volume, the set of hyperbolic structures, so of Fuchsian representation, that dominates rho is homeomorphic to a copy of Teichmuller space of genus G to T of G. This is a Teichmuller space . So we know that in fact this Teichmuller space is a ball 6G minus 6 dimensional real dimensional ball. So I could say this is just homomorphic to a ball. But in fact, the way Nicolas do is does is he gets a really natural parametrization of the set of Fuchsian representations that dominates Rho by Teichmuller space. So natural map from Teichmuller space to this set of representations that, so I forgot to word here. Sorry? Teichmuller space of S, right. So this is homeomorphic. This is well known, this homeomorphic tool. A ball of dimension, real dimension, 6G minus 6, right? So in fact, today I will not be able to give the proof of this theorem. It uses, in fact, too many materials. Namely, it uses harmonic maps, equivalent harmonic maps. But I will give a weaker statement, which which is the following. So, which is just the fact that if you take any Rho with the same hypothesis of non-maximal volume, then you can find a Fuchsian representation that dominates this Rho. And in fact, this is interesting because if you consider... Sorry? Right, you're right. Thank you. This is, yeah, in fact, I chose to not speak about conjugation, but so at each step, so you are completely right. So the set of conjugacy classes. So there is something which is completely evident. This is that if you have a representation that dominates another representation, then if you take some conjugates of the two representations, the same relation holds. So, okay, so you can, so if you have G that dominates Rho, if you conjugate J by some elements of PSL to R, the conjugation still dominates Rho. Okay, so thank you.
Sorry,
thank you.
That, there is something that was not
yes. Okay. Is it clear that okay? This is clear that you cannot have strict domination by a Fuchsian with another Fuchsian. So, okay. So you cannot have G strictly. Hello. Okay. So I didn't get your question. So. Right.
Something homeomorphic to Teichmuller space.
Right.
I'm asking, I guess, model conjugation is why is it not all of it? Every Fuchsian representation.
Ah, okay, okay. So if you take a Rho which is not trivial, you might find, a simple, let's say, a simple closed geodesics with which is mapped to a loxodromic element. So it has a certain translational length. But then you can find an element in Teichmuller space which pinches this geodesics, right? So this element will not dominate Rho. Okay, this is clear that the set of Fuchsian representations. So the question was, is it possible that fixing Rho, every Fuchsian representation dominates Rho? This is never true. Okay, this is always a set of representations, Fuchsian representation that dominates another one. Apart maybe for trivial representations and maybe some stupid examples. For most representation, all this set is strict in Teichmuller space.
Can you just remind the topology of space?
Right. So the space of representation of given volume, this is how to say that. This is So this is homotopy equivalent to a certain symmetric power of the surface, where the power depends on the volume. This is 2g minus 2 minus the volume, I think, minus the modulus of the volume. Okay? It is a theorem by Itchin. Okay? It uses Higgs bundles. No, in particular, it's connected, and this was proved originally by Gorman using different methods. Okay.
Can I ask you, the state of J is bounded? Like, the subset you're parameterizing bounded?
No, it's never bounded. Okay. In fact, it's never bounded. It is never bounded. So, in fact, as far as I understand, So Nicola gave a parametrization of this set of dominating representations, but the geometry of this set is still to be understood. I mean, as a subset of Teichmüller space. Okay. So, but we know that it is never bounded. Okay. So. So what I want to say now, I wanted to say something that I had to say at the really beginning of the talk, so when I made this definition of domination. So in Todd's talk, we had some domination problem also to construct this Margulis spacetimes. This domination in his context was formulated in terms of translationless or Margulis invariants. So in fact, this domination in this context of representation of surface group can also be given in terms of translationless. It is, so we will say that, so an equivalence statement, this is not at all trivial, it was proven again, Fanny's thesis, is that a representation dominates another representation if and only if you can see the domination at the level of the length spectrum. Namely, the length spectrum of the first one dominates the length spectrum of the second one. For those who don't know the length spectrum, just forget about what I just said. And but I just wanted to point out that, in fact, domination is something that you can read on the length spectrum of the representations, on the characters of the representations. Anyway, so now I want to, as I said, to prove a very weak version of this theorem, which were proved independently by the Gerito Cassel Wolf in the work I mentioned yesterday, and by myself and Nicola. So the following result. So were previously proved. this is that for any row with volume strictly less than 2g minus 2, so of non-maximal volume, there exists a J function strictly dominating rho. So it is not trivial, this statement. And also, in fact, there are also other kind of statements. For instance, in their paper, they prove that if you take any Fuchsian representations, then in any Euler class, I mean, any volume which is not maximal, you can find a representation of that volume which is strictly dominated by your Fuchsian representation you started with. So there is also other kind of opposite statement for this theorem, which was also originally maybe guessed or partially proved by François Salin. But today we will concentrate on this theorem, on this statement, I will try to give a quite complete proof of that statement. So maybe let's just analyze what what does it mean. So I would like to try to remind you that yesterday we spoke about geometrizations, and in fact this kind of statement is going to be a consequence of efficient geometrizations of a given representation rho. Okay. So in terms of a geometrization, I recall you that a geometrization or maybe it could be called, I don't know, a pre-geometrization is just a map from the universal cover of the surface to upper half plane, which is rho equivalent. And in fact, yesterday what we did is we just, out of such a map, we just extract the volume of a representation by taking the pullback of the volume form of the Poincaré metric by such a map, which gives, in fact, which is invariant by the fundamental group of S, and which gives rise to a volume form on the surface S. But in fact, what you can do is you can really try to think of S as being a geometric object out of this pre-geometrization by just pulling back the Riemannian tensor of the Poincaré metric. Right? So you might, instead of taking the volume, okay, you might think of your surface together with the pullback of Poincaré metric itself. Right? And in fact, it is a tensor which is not a Riemannian metric, because a priori this map D is not a summation, is not a, or even is not an immersion, sorry. So a priori there could be some direction in the tangent space of S where this tensor is going to vanish. And in fact, so as a geometric object, so, but you can still measure lengths of passes and define a kind of pseudo distance on your surface and get a geometric object. So the kind of geometric object that you will get by these procedures can be some, so S is, say, like that, but it would be really possible using such a map to get as a geometric object something which is degenerated like that, for instance, because that would correspond to the fact that some curve, on some curve, this tensor is vanishing, and so in terms of geometry, all this curve is going to be contracted to a point. So, for instance, you can get some degenerate, some collapsings. But still, you have a geometric object, and we will really try to think about this geometric object in the rest of the talk. Okay. So what really we will try to do to prove the statement, this statement here, okay, is the following problem. So we will try to think that to find a developing map, so a pre-geometrization, let's say, that can be dominated by by a hyperbolic metric on the surface S. So the problem, in fact, is find a good geometrization D and Riemannian metric G, let's say G on S, with which dominates this Riemannian tensor. So of course, if we dominate, strictly dominate like that, then we can find a certain constant C such that C is less than 1 and we have this inequality. And if we have such a thing, then we can, this is completely evident to see that this D is going to be a C Lipschitz map between the universal cover of the surface equipped with this metric to upper half plane, and this map is going to be rho equivariant. And so, in fact, if we think of the action of the fundamental group as being given by a Fuchsian representation that I call G, we will have that. We will have exactly that rho is strictly dominated by J. Right? So the problem is to find. So this is. I just shifted a little bit. I didn't say anything deep here. I just say that, in fact, you can translate. This is not a real translation, but you can try to find a certain geometrization of your surface in this sense, in that you can dominate by a Riemannian metric of curvature minus 1. And this will give you the answer. Okay. So, and now my claim is that if you find some efficient geometrization, you will get that. So let me give the construction. Yeah, so maybe we have shown yesterday two examples of geometrizations, and I would like to describe what looks like this kind of metrics for those geometrizations. So the first geometrization that we saw is in the proof that there exists some developing map. So I recall you, we took a triangulation of the surface, and we lifted the vertices of this triangulation to the universal cover. We assign any value for these lifts, and then we extend the map equivariantly, and we extend on the one and second part of the triangulation by using barycentric coordinates, let's say. So, in fact, in this geometrization, so we started with a certain triangulation of our surface, and recall that that was exactly the same. I mean, what we had is that we had replaced each triangle of this triangulation by a certain copy of a hyperbolic triangle in H2, and there was a sign assigned to the triangle. So the sign, there was some signs which correspond to the fact that the triangle was mapped by D with positive orientation or negative orientation in H. Okay. So in fact, what is this tensor in this case? So this is really easy to see what we get as a geometric object. It is just a hyperbolic metric with some conical angles. So we have some conical angles at the vertices. So in fact, if you glue two triangles along an edge, you don't have any problem. I mean, you just get a hyperbolic metric even on the edge, where the Riemann tensor is not. I mean, you could have some problem to glue, but in fact, you have no problem. You get really a hyperbolic surface. But what happens to the at the vertices? So in the vertices, what happens is that you can glue several angular domains, and it is unclear what is the value, total value of these angles. It might be different from 2 pi. So you get a kind of conical singularity coming here, but this is the only singularities that may happen in this case. So we get conical hyperbolic surface. So by that I mean a surface with a metric of curvature minus 1 apart from a certain finite number of points. And at these points, the geometric completion of the surface is just given by defined by a conical domain, which could be defined by you take a conical domain in H2, for instance, with an angle alpha, and you glue the two boundaries of this angular domain by an isometry. And so when doing so, you get the cone. So of course, here you get only cones with angles less than or equal to 2 pi. But in general, you can also define conical angles of angles with angles bigger than 2 pi just by taking, instead of taking some angular domain in upper half plane, you just take an angular domain which is above edge, I don't know, something like this. So the angle here is making 2 pi and then a little bit more, and you can make an arbitrary number of turns. So what I want to say is that the angle can be any positive real number, not negative, no. Because there is no sense of, the thing is oriented, so no, there is no, I mean, those are things that are isometric if you just invert the, okay. So so that was examples, let's call them baby geometrizations, let's say. And next, we saw another kind of geometrization, which was given by foldings. What happens for a folding? It's interesting to see what happens. So the geometry of the underlying tensor is just nothing but a hyperbolic metric without conical angles. So in the case of foldings, you just get a hyperbolic structure without conical angles. Why do you do so? Well, this is really evident. So if you have if you have a map which folds, suppose here you are. So suppose the map D, so here is H2. Assume that this region plus is mapped to the plus region here. Here is the geodesic. And assume this region minus is also mapped to the plus region in H2. So you have a folding. You have folded the minus part of S tilde to the plus part of S tilde, right? So then if you take the pullback of the Riemann tensor in a hyperbolic tensor in H2 by this map, because the folding, you can think of this as being just a reflection in H2, which is an isometry, then in fact, here you really get a hyperbolic metric of curvature minus 1. Okay, this is a model for that. It's just you take H, and you take a geodesic, and you take the map, which on one side of the geodesic is just the identity, and on the other side is just a reflection with respect to the geodesic, right? And because those maps are isometries, what you get as a tensor on your surface is just hyperbolic metric. Okay, so this is the reason here is just because the fold is a geodesic. But this was the case for foldings. So of course here, this is not so evident to see if you have laminations which are not just simple closed curve, but this is also true in this generality. Okay, so in fact, with the two examples I gave, it's quite easy to see what is the geometry for this tensor. And now what is interesting is, and what we will try to do is to try to find some geometrization which are going to produce some conical angles And in fact, more than conical angles, we want that the angles are big, namely bigger than 2 pi. So why we are going to look for that? This is for the following reason. Let me write a very classical lemma, which we have seen yesterday, in my first lecture in some form and in Romain's lecture yesterday, which is Schwarz, so a generalization of Schwarz lemma. I don't know in fact if peak and alphos were, I was trying to make something chronologic, but I'm not sure about these two guys. Anyway, there is maybe here, maybe. Sorry? I have to change? So you, right? I have to? Ah, here, okay. Right, thanks. Okay, so what is this lemma? So so the lemma tells the following. Let S be a closed Riemann surface, so of a large characteristic less than zero. G prime, two conformal matrix on S with the curvature of G less than the curvature of G prime. Then, and everything is strictly negative, so curvature of negative, so matrix of negative curvature, then G is dominated by G prime. Proof. So you have to write the formula that we proved. So recall that in the first lecture, I gave a formula which relates the curvature of curvatures of two conformal matrix in terms of the conformal factor between the matrix. So let's introduce this conformal factor. So right. So let, so proof. Let sigma, the function, so the conformal factor, so namely, what I mean by that is that let's write g equal to exponential sigma times g prime. Okay? They are conformal metrics, so you can find such a function. So sigma, let's say, is smooth, so let's say the two conformal, here, we are going to consider smooth conformal matrix. And so what we proved in the first lecture is that we have the following formula. So this factor is satisfying a certain partial differential equation that, remember, we solved in the first lecture. so the Laplacian of sigma with respect to g prime is just minus 2 times the curvature of g times exponential of sigma plus 2 times the curvature of g prime. Okay, so we proved this. And now what we want to prove, we want to prove that sigma is non-positive. So, okay, we want to prove that exponential of sigma is less than 1, so namely that sigma is non-positive. So assume the contrary. So let P be such that sigma attains its maximal value at P, and assume that sigma of P is positive. So it's really trivial application of maximal principle. Let's do it. Assume sigma is positive at p. So then, because sigma has a maximal value, its Laplacian with respect to g prime is non-positive, right? So we have so. This gives that the curvature of G prime at the point P is less than or equal to 2 times the curvature of G at the point P times exponential sigma of P. Okay, so but recall what we had as an assumption. We had an assumption on the curvature, so the curvature of G at the point P is bounded by the curvature of G prime at the point P, so we get a contradiction. This is what I note here, which goes back from yesterday night, 11:30, so maybe that is a mistake. Right? I think it is for with respect to G prime, but as I told you, so we are not going to verify this again now, but we can discuss it later, but I think it is with respect to G prime. Anyway, it doesn't change the argument here. Right. So anyway, this for any Laplacian, the Laplacian of the function attaining a maximal value is less than or equal to zero. So, but we can discuss this point later. So I'm trying to see if I have time to explain. So here, in fact, we will try to use a complement version of this lemma, which is due to Minda, which is a case of equality. And we will have to really use that for what he's going to. So because here you see that this lemma, so we are really happy with such a lemma because this is a way for creating dominations, right? But we want strict domination, and there is this so this complement which says the following. So if if there exists a point Q such that this inequality is strict, or let's say, so here is a complement. So this is the same statement, then, but the conclusion, so what proved Minda is the following conclusion. So this is Minda. He proved that under the same conditions, either you have strict inequality at any point, or the two metrics are in fact equal. So the proof of that is not completely trivial. You have to do some work. So in fact, you have to analyze what happens. So if you assume that, so what we have to prove is that if the maximal value of sigma at is equal to zero, then in fact sigma is identically equal to zero, and so we have to do some analysis close to a point attaining such that sigma attains its maximal value at zero, which is on the boundary of these sets of points, and I will not do that. In fact, I will not have enough time to describe that, and this is quite technical, so I would like to try to skip this. But it's elementary, but I didn't manage to recall the argument by myself. I had to come back to Minda's paper, so with the help of Nicola, so it's not so easy, I think. Let's skip that. So we have this stronger version where we can strictly dominate G by G prime if there is a point where the inequality here is strict. Okay. So here is another complement of this Fassel force peak lemma, which is the following. So maybe I should say that if you have, so if you have a conical hyperbolic surface, as I defined before, it gives rise to a Riemann surface structure. On the whole surface, so including the point where you have conical angles, this is very easy to define this conformal structure. So, for instance, if you take a domain, so suppose here I'm going to treat the case where alpha is less than or equal to 2p, which is not the case I will be interested in, but it will be simpler for what I conceptually for what I say now. So suppose you take such a domain, you have a coordinate here, which is z. So suppose it is a domain in a graph plane. So to create the conical angle, we identify these two these two boundaries by a isometry. And how to find the coordinate which is going to define a Riemann surface? Well, we have just to take a certain power of the variable z. Which is going to be something like 2 pi z to the power 2 pi over alpha. If I am not mistaken, it's going to describe, when z describes our angular domain, so the variable w is going to describe a whole disk. So we have multiplied the angle by this factor using this kind of transformations. And so we get really here the coordinates which is going to identify a neighborhood of the conical point to a disk, in upper half plane, or in complex numbers. So this coordinate is going to be the coordinates that defines our Riemann surface, right? So we have a Riemann surface given a conical hyperbolic surface, and in the opposite direction, if you have a Riemann surface. So to go in this way, maybe assume you have a Riemann surface, and to get let's say a conformal conical hyperbolic surface, so it's going to be a metric, conformal metric, which is going to have an expression like this. So in some complex coordinate for a Riemann surface, and we want that this function. So this function is going to be smooth apart from some finite number of points, which corresponds to the conical points of our structure. And this, this function has to satisfy such a differential, a partial differential equation, which is the expression that the metric is of curvature minus one. And at the conical point, G takes the form Z to the power two alpha minus two times some smooth factor, which does not vanish, times, of course, the Euclidean Riemannian tensor. So, in fact, the conical points in the expression of the chart of our Riemann surface structure has some singularities, which are just given by powers of the modulus of the coordinates. And you can read the conical angle in the power you are interested in. Okay? So you can just, to prove that, you just look, you just write that in the variable W, the conical metric you are interested in is just given by Poincaré metric, and you you write what does it mean, and you can prove that it means exactly that. So where phi is a function which does not vanish and which is smooth and continuous at the conical point. Okay, so now what is the version of the Schwarz-Alfors lemma complement that we are going to be interested in? So if G let's say G and G prime are conformal matrix of curvature minus one on the same Riemann surface I was considering with G prime, let me rephrase the thing differently. Sorry, I'm going to say it like that. So let S be a Riemann surface of negative Euler characteristic. G prime the Poincaré metric on S. And let now G be a conformal metric with curvature minus one and conical singularities of angle strictly bigger than 2 pi. What by this I mean that there are some conical singularities, a finite number, and there are one, at least one, which is strictly larger than 2 pi. Then G is dominated by G prime. For a certain constant C less than 1. And the proof of this is exactly the same proof as I explained before. So we just write G, we consider the density of G with respect to G prime, so this function sigma, the log of the density, and we write the partial differential equation that it satisfies everywhere apart from the conical points of the metric G. And we see that this density, because of the condition on the angles, has to tend to minus infinity at the conical point. As you see, when alpha, here the formula is 2 times alpha divided by 2 pi minus 2. So you see that when alpha is strictly bigger than 2 pi, this exponent is positive. So the log, so sigma is going to be given by the log of the modulus of z times a positive number, which decreases to minus infinity at the conical point. Okay, so you get that your sigma is going to infinity at the conical point, so you can just make exactly the same argument. You take the maximum of this function, it has a maximum, so... And you do exactly the same argument, and you get strict domination of G by G, by G prime. Okay, so this is extremely powerful because if you just apply this, you get the following statement that if you have a geometrization of a representation, which is a conical metric, and where the conical angles are bigger than 2 pi, then you can consider the underlying Riemann surface structure. You uniformize this surface, and you get a metric which is going to strictly dominate your conical hypermodic metric, which is exactly what we wanted to get. Okay? So in fact, the problem is how to find efficient geometrization namely conical matrix, so let's say hyperbolic matrix with conical angles strictly bounded below by 2 pi. So I'm going to indicate two ways of doing so. I'm going to say, so here I'm going to try to mix all the techniques of all the works I have spoken about. So first I want to say the following. So I make a remark. If you have a conical metric whose angles are strictly bounded from below by 2 pi, then in fact the volume of this metric is strictly less than the volume of a hyperbolic metric on the surface. Namely, it's strictly less than a large characteristic times 2 pi. I mean, 2g minus 2 times 2 pi because of Gauss-Bonnet formula. Okay, so in fact, you see that in a sense, it is efficient in the following sense that the volume of the geometrization has to be small. So in a sense, we are trying to get geometrization whose volume is small. And in some moment, I'm going to indicate how do you do. I mean, a general question, conjecture concerning this the problem of finding something geometrization with minimal volume. But anyway, so here is two steps. I'm going to just indicate the first one because I will not have enough time. So the first step is to take the geometrization by folding. So we start with a folding. Assume it is a folding along a set. So you have a hyperbolic structure. A folding is given by a hyperbolic structure, and the data of some disjoint simple closed curve. And at each time you cross such a simple closed curve, you fold. Okay. So of course, this geometrization gives rise to a hyperbolic metric. This is exactly the hyperbolic metric we started with. So we are not happy. We cannot dominate this by another hyperbolic metric. Okay, we have no cone angle, but how we can make a cone angle? It's extremely easy. Assume, look at the developing map here in this region. There is one region which is, so say this one and this one. There are two semidiscs. Assume the white semidisc is mapped by D to some semidisc in upper half plane. So here, this is upper half plane. And the blue one is also mapped in the same region, right? So now what you can try to do is you just move, you choose a point here, and you're going to replace your folding by another folding, which consists of moving, so the image of this point by D is here. So you move this point in the direction of the folding. What you get, and so you are going to get a folding in the following form. So here, you are. So the folding is going to it's not exactly the way you have to think about that. Okay, sorry. So so let's make a picture which is equivalent. So if you make a picture which is equivalent, you have, so I'm going to represent the universal cover of some neighborhood of the geodesic. Here on the left you have the white side, on the right the blue side. Of course, this is invariant by some element of the fundamental group, okay? And all this picture is mapped by the developing map by two something which is only on one side of such of one geodesic. Okay? So what I want to do is to replace the image, so the fold, okay, in the image, by something which goes in the region of the fold. Namely, I'm going to do something like this. So this point is going to move here. You just, in a sense, I want to say you eat the fold. You just erase the part of this fold, and it you just get something with here a conical angle, which is be the double of this point of this angle here. Why? Because what you have done is that if you look at the pre-image by the developing map of the yellow curve, you get these two curves, and what you do is you just erase this part and you glue these two parts together. Here you have conical angles which are bigger than pi on both sides, so when you glue you get some conical angle of angle bigger than 2 pi and you win. So you just win by doing this procedure. Okay? And let me just say two words. So there is a second way of doing things which uses equivalent harmonic maps. If you, so there is a theory which tells you that you can always find an equivalent harmonic map given a hyperbolic structure on your surface to upper half plane. And then if you use this map, you can show that the folds, in fact, have a convexity property. And in fact, when you do this procedure, you will find that the metric that you get, you can apply, you can uniformize that metric with appeal to uniformization theorem, apply Schwarz lemma, and you get domination also. So you can, this was the way we did with Nicolas. And so I think I will stop here.